Thank you for your kind words. I want to let you know it is an honor and a pleasure to be here. This opportunity from the Livingston Library, I think it was a time for me to pay back the library. I have been a very intense user. I use it all the time, so it's time to give something back. And also, the genesis of this presentation was last year. I said it's the 300th anniversary of the foundation of the Grand Lodge of London. We just can't let this thing go by under the table. We got to do something about it. And so I twisted some arms, and I'm a retired faculty at SUNY Cortland. So I got many friends there, and I gave a little talk there, which developed into what I am going to present today. I do want to let you know that this is a very ample topic, and what I'm going to present here is a very small window of the whole thing. I had the opportunity to review a book by Professor Andreas Onnefors, who is a Swedish scholar and also a Brother Mason, titled A Short Story of Freemasonry. And in his prologue, he says he wanted to give a story of this, the history of Freemasonry in 120 pages. And I had to do the review for the Latin American Academic Society that studies the history of Freemason. And my opening paragraph was that Professor Onnefors defined for himself an almost impossible task. And if he couldn't do it, I'm not going to do it either. What we're going to do here tonight is to have a conversation about the origins and relevance and historical overview of Freemasonry, where I will comment the highlights of what's going on, how this came to be, and what it's been doing in the first two centuries of its history, which is very interesting, and then link Freemasonry to civil society, which impacts all of us because we all, in one way or another, are part of civil society. And also, I'll talk a little bit about Freemasonry and academia. Freemasonry is a topic that has been more and more analyzed by academic researchers because there is a lot of interest. The Freemasons in the past 300 years have been vinculated, have been associated with the most important developments, social, economic, and political developments in many parts of the world. So definitely these people see in the study of Freemasons a window of opportunity to go deeper into that. And I'll give you an example of what we do in Masonic research because I'm part of that movement too, if I get time there. Hopefully I will finish tonight, and if I don't, maybe the Livingston Library will give me another opportunity next year to do whatever was not concluded today, and so on. So let's have a little bit of background about Freemasonry. Last year, in 1770, Freemasonry arrived in 2070. It arrived to its 300th anniversary because the first Grand Lodge, the Grand Lodge of London, was founded in 1717. When, on the 24th of June, the equinox and also the St. James, St. John's Day, the four London Lodges met to create the first Grand Lodge. This has been questioned by some recent researchers that say that it was not in 1717, that it was in 1721. Well, so what? I mean, what is important is that Freemasonry was created and its effects, its impact in society, what it brought into the world is here. And at that time, there were few records kept. Most of those records were either destroyed, burned, whatever else. So if it is true that it was 1721 and not 1717, that's fine with me. Before 1717, there were lodges. And they were, especially in England and Scotland and in the Irish island, because the business of building castles and cathedrals started drying up at the end of the 1500s. And there is a difference between a guild and a Masonic lodge. A guild is an association which is stable within a city where trade people have their association, like today would be a union. A Masonic lodge was a organization which was built, which operated in the building site. And the Masons would be working there, building whatever it is that they were building, a castle or a fortress or a cathedral. And they encompassed all sorts of people. And they were not only bricklayers, there were also architects, there were engineers, what would be today civil engineers, there were sculptors, there were painters, there were people who had to deal with water and windows and crystals, and the whole shebang, because they were all in this ability. And then, of course, they would travel from one building site to the next. They were free, which at that time were the people were serfs. They were tied to the land and they couldn't move. If the Lord cut them out of their fiefdom, they would go through severe punishment. But the Freemasons, the Masons at that time, could move from building sites to building sites. And when that dried up, that was during the Middle Ages, this society said, now what do we do? And they started admitting gentry. But they admitted gentry in places like England, which was a very interesting place to be. I have been in northern Spain in a museum, El Museo de los Canteros, museums of the Masons. And there were Masons all over Europe, but there was not a Masonic lodge. And it could not evolve in Spain because of the religious oppression of the Inquisition and all that stuff. You must pardon my Spanglish every now and then. When I get nervous, becomes very strong. So these individuals decided to start admitting people, and that's where the difference between operative Masons and accepted Masons came to be. Operative Masons were the Masons who built things, and accepted Masons were the gentry that were accepted into the Masonic societies and participated into them. People like, for example, Elias Ashmo, which was initiated in 1649, which was over half a century before the constitution of the first Grand Lodge. There are people who say that Oliver Cromwell was a Mason, which is not proven anywhere. The thing is that we all remember the French Revolution, and everybody forgets about the Cromwell Revolution, which was 150 years earlier. And they had a king that was oppressing the people. They chopped his head off and they proclaimed a republic, which only lasts 10 years because when Cromwell died, they went back to the heirs. You say heirs or hairs? Heirs. Of the king who had been deposed and beheaded. And the king was no better himself, nor his son or his brother. And eventually he was overthrown again. But it was because of those environments of the British society where the gentry became, had a parliament, they became politically active, they got together, that people started joining these Masonic groups. They could use the Masonic as a sort of a network and structure to talk and exchange ideas and so on and so on. So these Masonic lodges existed. And they existed in Scotland, they existed in England, they existed in Wales, but they were separate. And they did not have to do anything with each other. They independently operated. And then what happens is that four lodges in 1717 in the city of London decided to unite and create the Grand Lodge, which is like, if you like, a lodge of lodges. And then in the Grand Lodge, these four lodges created a structure which became, it evolved very quickly and became Freemasonry as we know it today. They were named after the public houses where they met. They met, and you can see here at the alehouse and at the other alehouse and the tavern and the tavern. So they met at very nice places where they would have beer, they would have good food, they would perhaps do a ceremony, and then they socialize. When we study this in academia, in the Spanish environment, we called it socialization, socialización. It was for networking. People became together, they exchanged ideas, which was very good. And it was a fellowship where people met each other and helped each other and worked together for good purposes, okay? So these four lodges decided to create a Grand Lodge. And the leaders of this movement were Jean de Sagulier, which was from French origin, and he was a Grand Master in 1719. He was extremely important in member of this group. The second important member, and this is not in the order of hierarchy or importance, it's just they put it in that way, James Anderson, who wrote the constitutions, which is the document that provides the structure, the order, the laws, the regulations, and it's still used today with some modifications in 1723. And George Payne, who was a Grand Master in 1718 and in 1720. These individuals, plus these others, Martin Folks, Alex Choke, and John Beale, they have new ideas. Some of them were from the pro-Hanoverian environment. You have to understand what was going on in Britain at that time. There were the descendants of King James who were Catholic, and England was a country which was not very friendly or pro-Catholic. It was mainly anti-Catholic since Henry VIII and Elizabeth and so on. So they didn't want another Catholic king, especially one which was very friendly with the French king, which was their political enemy. And so what this king had almost a posthumous son, because he was very old and this son appeared, and they realized that when this king dies, this young king is going to be Catholic, is going to be pro-French. They overthrew him in what was called the Glorious Revolution of 1689, and they introduced their Bill of Rights, which gave all these liberties and so on and so on, and they brought up the king, William of Orange, which was a stadtholder of the Dutch Republic. The Republic, at that time, it's not a republic like ours here, it was an aristocratic republic, but nevertheless, it was some beginnings of a republic. These guys were Whigs, which at that time was the liberal version of the politics, and they were pro-Hanoverian. The problem with that is that the Hanover dynasty, which is the one that's still reigns today. They changed their name to Windsor because in the First World War, the Hanoverian sounded too German, and they thought it was better to call themselves something else. But anyway, these guys were new. They went into power in 1815, and still the descendants of King James, which called themselves Jacobites, they were exiled in France. They were always, like every exile, thinking next Christmas in Havana, next Christmas in London, and so on and so on. So anyway, I'm Cuban by origin, so. And then they were a threat to this this Hanoverian dynasty, which was just catching up. And so they brothers each other. They created the Freemasons as a society that would help the Hanoverian dynasty. There is an excellent paper, by the way, if you're familiar with Ars Quadrus Coronatorum, which is the magazine, the book that takes the yearly works of the Ars, the Quatuor Coronator Lodge, which is the research lodge in London. And Professor Rick Berman has a good, very good paper based upon that. So these guys, which were pro-Hanoverian, organized the, took over the movement of the Grand Lodge, converted it into a pro-Hanoverian organization. Not all Masons were pro-Hanoverians. The Grand Lodge in York, for example, was a Tory. But that, you know, that's okay. Freemasonry, as was created in 1717, had a lot of features which were revolutionary at that time. Provided the formal structure. Before that, lodges did pretty much similar things, but differently. Now, things, you know, they established the degrees, they established how the degrees would be made, how they would be known and named, and so on and so on. They had common rules, you know. And they decided we're all going to, we have a belief in God, we have a belief in the aftermath, and they provided some rules and so on. Visitation rights. Before the Grand Lodge, every lodge was on its own, and now you could go visit one lodge and the other, and that's one of the good strengths that we have kept today. And a modern philosophy that I will show you in the next page. And some of these individuals were very strong in the Enlightenment. The Enlightenment was the movement, the philosophical movement of the times. The guys who were running this movement created the Encyclopedia, which was a very large book where, you know, Diderot, Montaigne, Voltaire, and all those guys wrote these beautiful articles about freedom, about how the social contract should work, about the equality of rights, and the whole idea of the Enlightenment. So in that sense, it was an extremely interesting experiment. It was the beginning of the modern civil society. The revolutionary concepts that came in with the creation of the Freemasonry as we know it today were the following, and were very important because it was the negation of everything that existed at that time. Men were assessed by their merits and not by their wealth or by their social status. Okay, I couldn't care less if your great-grandfather was the Duke of whatever or the Count of Monte Cristo. What have you done? Okay, don't tell me what they did. Tell me what you're contributing now. What's your merit? And that's what I'm going to judge you for. Today we take it for granted. In 1717, I'm sorry, that was not the story. The lodge leadership was elected and not the hereditary. My God, that was a real transformation. At that time, people were either kings and they were obtained their position by hereditary, or people were appointed. The Pope appointed the cardinals appointed the bishops appointed the parishes and so on. And, you know, the idea that a leadership would be elected, that was anathema at that time. Members observed religious tolerance. At that time, there was no such a thing as political, multiple political parties. It was just starting. The Tories and the Whigs were a little bit different, so on and so on. But in general, what existed was different religions. The after the Luther's protest, the different Protestant religions or Protestant denominations started multiplying, and in England there were many, many, many pros the Church of England. So what these guys came up was a genial idea. They said, okay, you have your religion, I have mine. So that's fine. We're going to work together. We're going to cooperate, and we're going to accept each other, toleration, acceptance, and so on and so on. So they observed religious tolerance. Today, we observe not only religious tolerance, we observe political tolerance. And in a lot, you have people who are in this country, for example, Democrats, Republicans, people who are independent, people who couldn't care less about what they all belong to the same lodge, and they get along perfectly well. Such ideas had a strong impact in developing modern Western thought. Modern Western thought, as it exists today, started moving in the 17th centuries in the present direction. Right. So, these are the Freemasons. What are the Freemasons? It's a very interesting thing. A couple of months ago, we tried to do some outreach in our community, and we put together a career day. And some kids came, and we had the triangles, and we had the mole, and the whole nine yards. And after, we opened the lodge, and there was this lady who came with her daughter. And I said to her, how would you like to go up and see a Masonic lodge? And she said, oh my God, she turned white. You guys have all these secrecies. No, we're not a secret society. We are a discreet society, so it's like a family. You know, in a family, your son is getting a divorce. You're not gonna go all over the neighborhood saying, my son is getting a divorce, this and that happened. That's an internal thing of the family. And the same thing happens in a lodge. And we don't do bad things, we don't do forbidden things, but the things that we do that don't have to do with anybody else, we keep it to ourselves. But we have open sessions and people can come in. For example, installations usually are open, and we have Christmas and Thanksgivings and all these things. You can bring your significant others, you can invite your friends, you can see a lodge in the inside. We have no tails or horns, we don't bite people. We try to do good things. We try to make some good men better. We are not a reformatory, we don't take bad men. We take good men, and this is a self-improvement society. We try to, by our training and the things that we do, we try to make them better. And of course, some of these better men think then how to make better the community where they live and so on. So the impact in society is good. Our organization is independent of the government. We are not a political party. We don't depend on the government. And we do not talk partisan politics. Some people say everything is politics, and that's okay, but partisan politics is another story. Education, you know, we are in favor of education, and for example, if you belong to the Scottish Rite, we do things in favor of helping people, students who have some problems like dyslexia and things like that, and that's things that we do. We are not associated with religion, even though, as we say, no man should start any endeavor, serious endeavor, without first invoking the aid of the deity. We call the deity the great architect, the supreme gran arquitecto.
The great architect.
And the reason for that is that we have, in my lodge, for example, we have Muslims, we have Protestants, we have Catholics, we have Jews. And different people from different denominations, different religions, they call the gods in different names. So, in order to find a neutral, over-encompassing denomination and not start repeating ourselves all the time, we say the grand architect, and that's it. Covers everybody, and everybody is happy. So we don't argue about religion, and if something goes starts into that way, there's somebody in the lodge, the president of the lodge, called the master of the lodge, and he has a gavel, and brothers, that's off, and we move into another. So we're based upon brotherhood and tolerance. Okay. And that's good because civil society, of which Freemasonry is part of, is a continuum. Freedom society, civil society is not like, you know, it's either there or not. Now, civil society is like kaleidoscope, it's like the arco iris, the rainbow. It's like the rainbow. It exists in some form of degree. The groups, like the Masons, are independent from the state. They are not necessarily antagonistic to the state or pro-state. They can be anything or nothing, okay? And they are not politically motivated. Some of these groups are religious, some of these groups are sport groups. So civil society is, and civil society came out of movements like Freemasonry, which was one of the first elements or organizations of modern civil society. It's freedom society is a strong indicator of a free society. You can always see in a society which is not free that there are not too many civil societies organizations. Now, what is the contribution of Freemasons to civil society? Okay. Freemasons are incubators of citizens. A good Freemason, a good Mason is a good citizen. It's respectful of the authority. A good Mason is a person that is informed, that if you're living in a democracy, is interested in the elements that are on the table at the time, on the people that have to deal with those elements, and can have whatever opinion. You can have an opinion in favor of this candidate or against that candidate, and that's fine, but it is an informed opinion. And the day of the elections, they go vote. Because, and if they want to go into politics, they go into politics. They are incubators of new ideas. The lodges are places of exchange, a very civil exchange, because of brotherhood and fellowship, okay? And I can advance a concept, and you may disagree with it, and you may advance an opposed concept, and we may talk, and we arrive to the conclusion that we agree to disagree, like human beings and decent people. And it increases the social capital because the different groups can interact. You have Freemasons is a masculine group. I mean, there are groups for women. The Eastern Star, for example. There are groups for kids and so on and so on. But we get together every now and then, but we keep, this is part of our tradition, okay? But there are different groups, there are different trades, there are different social classes, there are different races, there are different religions, and we all sit together in lodge next to each other. We learn to accept each other, we learn to respect each other, we become friends. One of the things, I write a little column for, we have a Central New York Masonic newspaper once a month, and one of the things I said in one of the columns is, in the years of 1950, 1960, you had a very significant percent of Freemasons in society. I did a study, and about 10 to 12% of adult males were Freemasons at that time. And that meant that in Congress and in the Senate, there were many senators and congressmen, and they were more civilized today. And I sat down and I said, how was that possible? And I said, well, it seems to me that if you and I are sitting in the Senate together, and I call you my brother tonight here in the lodge, it's very difficult for me to call you an SOB tomorrow in the silent floor. So people were more civilized, and that's so tolerance, acceptance, respect, fellowship, brotherly love, and also democratic rules and procedures. A lodge has a charter. Before, that's one of the big things that Freemasonry did. Before Freemasonry, society functioned at the whim of the person who was at the helm, at the fiat of the king. I will do this, and then I will, you will do that, and that's it. And there's no recourse. I said it, and you do it, whether you like it or not. The lodges, they have a bylaws. The Grand Lodge has its bylaws. The bylaws have to be observed. If you do not observe them, there is a tribunal where you can take your claim, and the tribunal assesses it and provides a solution to the problem. Okay. So that was a very significant advance. Now let's go back and do a little bit of history. In the 18th century, which means the 1700s, England, France, and the Dutch Republic, they grew Freemasonry very, very fast. In England, I already said, you know, it spread like fire. This Grand Lodge of London started the movement, and then it spread. It spread to Scotland, it spread to Wales, it spread to Ireland. And then some of these Jacobite exiles in France, they were also Masons, and they started a movement in France. And the French at that time had colonies, and they started, some of their people moved to the to America, to their colonies, and they brought their lodges there. Some of these people later became, like for example, Voltaire was a Mason. And some of these encyclopedists, some of these people of the Enlightenment were Masons, and they talked about their ideas, and they advanced some of the ideals of the French Revolution. The Dutch Republic was very much in contact with England, so much so that King William was the stadtholder or president of the Dutch Republic. And they competed with each other because they were both maritime powers, and they had a lot of exchanges. So there were many, many Masons also in the Dutch Republics. And they were seamen and merchants, so they carried their lodges with them. The Irish were soldiers, and in the England were soldiers, and they created many military lodges. And as the military lodges moved around, they created other lodges. In America, in the United States, and other American colonies like Jamaica, for example, some of the English people that came, they came and they opened here provincial Grand Lodges. And they, for example, St. John's Lodge in New York, St. John's Lodge in Boston were the first lodges that were created. In Philadelphia, I think the first lodge was created around 1730 or so. And Ben Franklin was a master of the Grand Lodge of Philadelphia around the 1730s somehow. So in the rest of the continental Europe, at that time in Spain, there was the Inquisition, so forget about Freemasonry. Italy did not exist because it was fragmented into 100 pieces, and so was Germany. The only thing that existed at that time around there was Prussia, which later became Germany. And the King of Prussia was a Mason, and so was the King of Sweden. So it caught the idea. But there were two types of Freemasonry. There was the aristocratic Freemasonry, and for example, the French nobles created all of these degrees, some of which had all of these rites, some of which had 100 degrees, and many of them disappeared, but the Scottish rite, for example, comes from there. And that's where Etienne Morin comes. Haiti at that time was the richest colony in America, even though Haiti is little like this, it was richer than any other colony, including the United States or anything else that existed here. And this Morin guy, he was from Bordeaux, which is a seaport in the Atlantic coast of France, and he got a patent and came to Haiti and then created what later became the Scottish Rite. And he had a friend, which was Franken, which was English of Dutch ancestry, and lived in Jamaica, and he also became a Scottish Rite member. And the interesting part for us is that Franken came to Albany because he was Dutch, and at that time those lands had been Dutch until the English had gotten them, and he came to Albany and he created a lodge of
Scottish Rite.
Yeah, Scottish Rite, yeah. La Logia de, at 25 degrees. And he created the lodge in Albany, which was also very interesting. The rest of the continental things in Europe did not count. In Europe, especially in England, there was a very important movement in this 1800s, in the 1750s or so. The aristocratic English had taken over the English Grand Lodge. And the Irish that were coming to London, they were considered riffraff because they were laborers, they were poorer, they were less educated, and they didn't want any, the aristocratic English didn't want to do anything with this guy. So what they did is they created their own Grand Lodge, and what they said was, these guys, aristocrats, are doing things that have changed the nature of Freemasonry, are doing things differently. We're going to go back to the old ways. And they call themselves the Antians. So by default, the English aristocrats were called the moderns. and they hated each other, and you know, they were always quarreling. They got back together in 1813, but during those 60 years, 1753-54 until 1813, they would come to America, and they would found lodges here. And it's very interesting. If you find a Grand Lodge in America that is called Ancient Antiguos Libres y Aceptados Masones, how do you say? Ancient Free and Accepted Masons. The ancient is because those Grand Lodges were formed by the Antians. And if you find a Grand Lodge that is only Free and Accepted Masons, those were founded by the modern. And in New York State, for example, and I will defer this to Gary Heinmiller, which has just been nominated the Grand Historian of our Grand Lodge, and he's a member of my, he's a secretary of my lodge. And I am trying to bend his arm to see if he comes here. He is very knowledgeable, that's his field, to talk about the history of the Grand Lodge of New York. But in the Grand Lodge of New York, we started with one way, and then the revolution came, the independence came, and the guys who had given us the charter didn't want to give us, so the other guys gave us the other charter, and we ended up being what we are today. It is a very interesting, see, in Jamaica there was Franklin, and Franklin got this lodge of 25 degrees that later became a Scottish Rite Lodge in Albany in the 1780s or some 1770s or things like that. In the 19th century, the U.S. became independent from England, and so were the lodges. All these provincial lodges declared themselves independent, became grand lodges on their own, and had nothing else to do with England. In the Caribbean, it is a very interesting development. Haiti, as I said before, was an extremely rich island. Half of the island was French. And they operated on the basis of slave work. And they used the slaves without misericordia. How do you say that in English?
Mercy.
Without mercy. If you have or have an idea of how to operate a business of truck business, that's how they operate in the slave business. In the truck business, you say, okay, I have 100 trucks. I'm going to buy 500 tires, and I know each tire is going to last for 3,000 miles. When they arrive to 3,000 miles, I'm going to throw them out. I'm going to put another tire. That's exactly how they use the slaves. The average life of a slave in Haiti was 8 years. And they knew that. The accountants knew that. So they brought the slaves as soon as they were like a tire. They threw them out and put another one in. And, of course, that was not sustainable in a colony with 500,000 people, of which 450,000 were black slaves, and the other 50,000 were divided into free blacks, what we say, mestizos, which
mixed.
Is mixed, free mixed, like Petion and all the other guys, which were wealthy and had mixed race, and then there were poor whites, and then there were the so. There was a big, big revolution there. The whites got either out or exterminated. And those who got out, they went to the two immediate islands. They went to Cuba and they went to Puerto Rico. And they brought with them the lodges. They didn't last there very much because Napoleon invaded Spain, and there was a war against Napoleon in Spain. And they were declared persona non grata, and they had to move on. They went to New Orleans, which was French at the time, and to South Carolina, which at that time was one of the richest cities in the United States, Pennsylvania, and New York. And a very interesting individual was master of a French lodge in Havana, was Mr. Surnault, which, if we know a little bit about the Scottish Rite Northern Masonic jurisdiction, he came in to New York State and created his own Scottish Rite Supreme Council, which he called the Supreme Council of the United States. It would encompass everybody, the North, the South, and everything. And that was something on its own. So that was Surnault. He came out of there. A lot of these French came either to New Orleans, and they created a council, a Scottish Rite and Supreme Council there, under Foucault's, how do you pronounce that? Foucault's? Yeah, the French guy. And then they created, some of them went to South Carolina and created the mother Supreme Council with John Mitchell and the other ones in 1801, but that's another story. So they created some ideas of, they didn't last much, but in the Spanish colonies, they created some awareness, okay? They created Scottish Rite in Louisiana and Charleston. And in the rest of the continent, the Freemasons became the liberals, as opposed to the church has always been, the Catholic Church in particular, had always been the ideological force of absolute monarchies and the right. And the revolutionaries and the liberals became affiliated. Victor Hugo, for example, was a Mason. And some of these intellectuals in France were Masons. Napoleon created a Grand Lodge and put his brother-in-law in charge of it and tried to use the Grand Lodge as a political tool. In Italy, you had Garibaldi, which his organization is not really Freemason. It's paramasonic. It has some, at that time, we call them revolutionary fraternities. They had sociedades patrióticas, we say in Spanish, patriotic societies. And they had, many of these guys who organized these patriotic societies were Masons, so they organized their society. For example, in the Dominican Republic, there was a society called Los Trinitarios, which was organized by the father of the Dominican Republic. And he was a Mason, and he organized it. But it was not a Masonic lodge. It was the spirit using those things. So, scholars. Margaret Jacobs is a professor at UCLA, and she has studied Freemasonry as an academic for years and years, and she's come up with some ideas. She says, first and foremost, lodges were a school of government. The people who entered the lodge, they started electing their leaders. They're starting judging men by their character and by their merit. And therefore, that was the beginning of a democratic government. The creation of constitutionally governed societies, they had a charter, they had a bylaw, they had to live with that. It was not the deal that I am the master of the lodge and I do what I want, and if you don't like it. Lodges were spaces in a new zone of civil society, because if you set a foot out of the lodge, you went back into the old scheme where the dukes were better than the counts, and the counts were better than the earls were better than everybody else, and so on and so on. And then merit should be the sole criteria for status within the lodge. You will work your way up, your promotion was grounded upon your real worth. What did you do for us? Okay, your personal merit. How good are you? And that, and she has written a few books, some of which are here in the library. Okay. In 20th century, we saw in the first half, Freemasonry flourished, the growth of the craft. By the way, if you are not a Mason, you may hear the word, the craft. And Masons usually refer to Freemasonry as the craft, for short. And it grew a lot, especially between the two world wars. It had its maximum maybe in the late 40s, early 50s. There were millions of Masons in the country, and it was a very good thing to be a Mason. You met a lot of people, you had a lot of network support, and so on and so on. Then, in the second half of the century, it stabilized first, and then it decayed. The only country, and I have studied several countries. The membership. The only country in the world that I know of where membership in the Freemasons has increased in the second half of the 20th century is Cuba. No questions. Okay, and there are many reasons. We're not going to go into that now. But in the rest of the world, life has become very complicated. It's a sign of the times. I smile. Today in a lodge and in the Grand Lodge and in all Grand Lodges, everybody's running around like a headless chicken We're losing people, we're losing membership. It's the sign of the times. I sing in the choir of my church. I go to church every week. And the choir today is the organist, myself, and there's an old lady there. And that's it. You know, 10 years ago, we were 10. 20 years ago, we were 15. People are not going to church. People are not going anywhere. People are not even going to the movies anymore. The movies used to be a social event. Now you got Netflix. And you stay home. It's the sign of the times. It will pass because we are social animals, human beings. We like to talk to other people and exchange ideas. And that's how ideas grow. And that's how we personally grow. So I'm not so concerned. Maybe it's a blessing in disguise. Maybe we have, and I'm talking here to those of us in this room which are Freemasons. It is an opportunity that we have to strengthen our organization. Okay? And make better Masons of whatever we have left. And then our society is going to grow again. Okay? Because Freemasonry, in my mind, is not a mass movement. Okay? It's not. You will never have 100,000 Freemasons. Like you have 100,000 members in a political party or something like that. But you might have 10,000 men of character, of worth, and so on. And that's maybe what we need. So we're working renewal efforts, and the Masonic Society is working and studying that. There is an association called Masonic Renewal, and they have a website, and they are doing a lot of things, studying a lot of things to do that. Okay. As an academic topic, these are all academic places. SEME is a center for the study of the history of Freemasonry in Spain and its colonies and former colonies. And I belong to that. And every 3 years we have a symposium, and there's about 20 volumes of that. REMLAC is the Latin American version of this. We have an electronic magazine every 6 months. It's in the internet, it's free. UCLA in the history department has a very strong department that teaches things like that. There are many PhDs, dissertations. I have come here to the library and have found on and off young persons that are doing their PhDs in that. And then they send me, when they're done, they send me their things. If you're taking pictures, okay, good. These are speaking forums, English speaking forums. You have American Lodge of Research and the Western Lodge of Research. This is the Livingston Library. The Grand Lodge of Iowa has an extraordinary library. The Ars Quattro Coronatorum has a webpage, that's the English Society. UCLA, the Scottish Rite has a very good library, but if you're not a Scottish Rite member, it's more difficult for you to get there. We have in Puerto Rico the Voice Lodge of Research, and this is our Grand Lodge there. This is the Grand Lodge of Cuba. Again, you know, this is in Spain, Asturias. There are websites. You can just go into the internet and you'll find all the Freemasonry in Spain, in here. You got to be careful because there's all sorts of things that you can see there, okay? There have been two symposiums in Cuba, one in 2007, and there is a recent one that occurred last year, okay? There was one in Costa Rica and one in Mexico. I went to these two, and the other two, since I came out of there, I kind of keep away for the time being until I see clearer. But they put out very interesting academic work. And they, very interesting, when we went to the symposium of Costa Rica, the Grand Master of the Grand Lodge of Costa Rica was there, was present. He participated. There were papers presented by brothers there. And when we went to Mexico, it was the same thing. And in the symposium of Havana, I didn't go, but I followed it through the internet. And the Grand Master of the Grand Lodge of Havana, who has been here, And you have talked with your number, same number in the Grand Lodge there. And these guys have been part of these. They have a session. They sponsor a session. And I have talked on and off with people and say, why would the Grand Lodge of California put together things with UCLA? Why doesn't the Grand Lodge of New York at some point try to twist some arms? There's tens of universities in New York City. Maybe we could find one who would be willing to do that. Okay, in the 19th century, there is some research that I did, and this applies, you know, one thing about Freemasonry is that Freemasonry is the product of men. We do have a charter, we do have general things that we have to follow, the Los Antiguos Limites, which in English is called the
landmarks.
The landmarks. Thank you very much. This is my brother from Fraternidad, he's from Latin America too. And the landmarks, we have to obey them all. But we are men, so the lodges in the United States are not exactly the same as the lodges in the Caribbean. I remember when I first came here, some people talked to me about the blue lodges. And I didn't have a clue what they were talking about. I don't know what these guys are talking about. What is a blue lodge? Because where I come from, in Cuba, in Puerto Rico, in the Dominican Republic, the lodges are not blue, they are red. Because they follow the ritual of the Scottish Rite, not the ritual of the York Rite. So here you go to a lodge and the curtains are blue and maybe the walls are blue. And in Cuba you go to a lodge and you find, in Puerto Rico you go to a lodge and you find that everything. If I had brought my apron is red, Master Mason apron. And so things are different. And also some applications and things because of people. But they do pretty much the same things. The functions that I found that were prevalent in the Caribbean lodges in the 19th century were they were connecting functions. They would have people who thought in a similar way, who upholded the same principles. They tended to flock together. And where did they flock together? In the Masonic Lodge. And they discussed and polished their ideas and polished themselves and became better leaders and better men. It was an incubator function. They created new organizations. At a given point in time, they said, we have overgrown this lodge. Lodge is not a political party. So what did they do? They created a political party. And in Cuba and in Puerto Rico in the 1880s, which were colonies from Spain, we were looking for the autonomy, like Canada, for example, from England. And the autonomic parties were created by the Grand Masters and secretaries of the Grand Lodge, and the leaders of the autonomous party were in great numbers. My specialty in the research is the Spanish Caribbean, so what I say here with that may not apply in other places, and that's fine. Okay. This is an example of what a research can do. This is in statistics. It's called a contingency table. We have here two factors. The first factor is being or not being a Mason, and the second factor is participating or being a member of or not being a member of a autonomic government. You have seen this in other places. For example, people have studied the association between cancer and smoking. So you would have smokers and non-smokers, those who suffer cancer and those who do not suffer cancer. And then there is an expected number if it is a random assignment, but if there is an association, that random assignment is going to be not there. There will be many more than what you would expect after a random assignment and what you observe in reality. That's the principle of the contingency table. And here you have a contingency table for Masons and non-Masons, and outside are members of the government. You have in red the observed, and you have in black the expected. If this was a random movement, if being a Mason had no relevance, then you would observe that there would have been only there would have been seven non-Masons here, and there would have been three Masons in the autonomous government. This is in Puerto Rico. But actually it is reversed. And why is it reversed? Because the Masons were very, very strongly working for that and became leaders. So the statistical analysis shows a strong association between leadership and membership. One of the most important things that Freemasonry did for the Caribbean was to nurture, train, and
Promote
the leadership, thank you very much, of these things. So the number of leaders in the autonomic movement is much larger than the size of their or social work, right? So that's the result of this research. Which, so in the case of Cuba, Puerto Rico, and the Dominican Republic, Freemasonry was a very strong force for leadership, and they contributed to the autochthonous lodges contributed to the fight for, or the struggle for autonomy and later for independence when autonomy was not granted. This is what I have. As you see, it's a commented walkthrough. And if you have any questions, I will be more than happy. Thank you very much.